Decades of tenuous peace in Europe came to a horrifying and catastrophic end in recent weeks when Russian dictator Vladimir Putin began raining destruction on the sovereign territory of the nation of Ukraine. Millions fled in the face of the unfolding tragedy. The images of carnage rippled across social media in a way rarely seen since the medium's inception. Apartment complexes whose skeletal structure had been exposed by wounds from rocket attacks watched over streets strewn with the burnt-out shells which once were cars, coated in a thick layer of ash, born from the earthly possessions of those who once called the buildings their home. Streams of refugees carrying their children and pets on their back poured over the borders with neighboring Poland and Romania, leaving behind their homes and, in many cases, their fathers, husbands, and brothers who have been forbade from leaving the country. The ever-present videos of Russian equipment abandoned in the field when the freshly conscripted teenagers that Putin has sent to die chose to flee rather than perpetrate the crimes their orders contained show them being scooped up later by enterprising Ukrainian farmers with their tractors and pickup trucks, hidden from the enemy, or perhaps even put into service against them. I have a video in the works dealing with the situation in more depth that will release in the coming weeks, but for now, I want to examine what the music made by those who've lived through conflicts like this take the form of. The first instinct is to latch on to protest music as the defining artistic expression of wartime angst, a weary people demanding that the military-industrial complex stop chewing up and spitting out their brothers and sisters in pursuit of higher profit margins at the expense of filling mass graves. But there's been a mountain of writing done about protest music, and I have little interest in rehashing others' analysis. Rather, I'm going to focus on music that draws from the human experiences of those affected by war, in a variety of different ways, and with a variety of different executions. I want to clue in on the voices of the people who exist in the margins of conflict, the ways in which they express their anger, sorrow, and struggle in song, and the characteristics that are shared amongst the way each individual war is portrayed through the human lens. The modern era of popular music dealing with war has been defined by two main conflicts. In the late 60s and early 70s, it felt like every single artist released a song dealing, at least in part, with the US invasion of Vietnam. Creedence Clearwater Revival's signature tune Fortunate Son is a fiery rebuke of the system that sent working class boys to die while the rich escaped the horrors of the jungles, a dichotomy embodied by future presidents Bill Clinton and Donald Trump, who have been dogged with allegations of draft dodging through various means over the years. The Beatles' later career and subsequent solo works are littered with anti-war songs, both in a macro sense like Gimme Shelter, and more specifically focused on the conflict at hand like Revolution. Vietnam coincided with a cultural revolution in the United States that saw a shift away from the patriotism that permeated out from the heyday of post-World War nationalism towards a more nuanced and informed public demanding accountability for an increasingly shadowy government apparatus that had begun sprouting appendages like the CIA and FBI. The other ubiquitous conflict is what I want to focus on, however. The Troubles, the turbulent period of Northern Irish history that saw terrorism, violence, and destruction reign in cities like Belfast, was a constant source of inspiration for a generation of Irish musicians, many of whom turned their mourning and anger into chart-topping smash hits. The sectarian conflict is centuries old, a long-simmering wound on both Ireland and the United Kingdom, born from the long-term occupation and subjugation of Ireland under the umbrella of the British Empire. The Republic of Ireland won its independence before the outbreak of the Second World War, which should have in all logical timelines been the end of things. However, the British maintained control of the northern portion of the island, centered around the city of Belfast, as it possessed a sizable population of British immigrants and Protestant citizens who were considered Unionists. Unionist rule would lead to bitter hatred and resentment amongst the oppressed Irish Catholics, many of whom saw the continued Unionist rule as a continuation of the centuries of occupation that preceded the independence of the broader Irish Republic. This resentment would lead to the creation of terrorist groups like the IRA, armed and funded by Irish expats in the United States and over the border with the neighboring Irish Republic. The group would carry out devastating attacks in public spaces with little regard for human life, and the battles between them and Unionist police forces boiled over in the period known as the Troubles. U2, one of the most commercially successful rock bands in the history of popular music, has dealt with the topic on a number of occasions, but none more profoundly on the aptly titled Sunday Bloody Sunday, a rousing call to arms whose message is of anti-violence. Frontman Bono makes it clear he has no dog in this fight. He rejects out of hand the idea of picking a side in the sectarian bloodshed, a position which makes him a natural enemy of both factions, and one that is probably born, at least in part, from his origins as the product of an interfaith marriage himself, making him in many ways the living embodiment of a middle ground. Indeed, the song's release and subsequent popularity sparked intense backlash from the IRA and affiliated factions, culminating in a threat of violence and kidnapping against the band's members if they continued to perform it live. The IRA's vitriol was curious, however, as the titular Bloody Sunday that serves as one of the subjects of the song's ire was an attack on civilians perpetrated by the IRA's sworn enemies, the Royal Ulster Constabulary Service, a Protestant police force often accused of indiscriminate violence towards Catholic citizens. U2 made special point to make it clear that the source of their rage was the violence itself, with the second verse reading, quote, "Welcome bodies on the children's feet, bodies strewn across the dead in the street. I won't eat the bed, no call, but it's my backup. Growing up in a country torn apart by war leaves an indelible mark on one's psyche no matter the belligerence, but there's something even more jarring when the violence is perpetrated indiscriminately by those you would call your neighbors. U2 manages to create a sonic atmosphere that perfectly evokes the angst and anxiety that comes with such a situation. Drummer Larry Mullen's backbeat evoking the stomp of a military marching band sets the foundation that Guitars to the Edge builds upon, trading in his usual sparklingly clean, delay-drenched guitar tones for a much harsher, more jagged sound that creates a moody, unsettled atmosphere. The pre-chorus has the sound of a sigh of exasperation. The chord progression and violin accompaniment evokes the exhale of anxiety, the collective ragged breathing of a people trapped under the curtain of asymmetrical warfare fought not between soldiers on a battlefield, but between martyrs on the streets of Belfast, with little regard for the collateral caught in the middle. Bono's call for unity, which also serves as the song's chorus, showcases that he believes the fighting spirit of the Irish can be harnessed for more than violence. Buttressed by the military-style drumming of Mullen's backbeat, creates the atmosphere of recruitment to a third side in the conflict, the side of de-escalation, of disarmament, of peace. 10 years after the release of Sunday Bloody Sunday, Irish alternative rock band The Cranberries took their own swing at the topic in the form of their defining tune, Zombie. Dolores O'Riordan's analysis of the war reads less like a call to arms and more so an accusation. It's a statement whose purpose is to impart on anyone who will listen what the horrors of this conflict have wrought upon the populace of Northern Ireland over the previous 80 years. It's the same old team, since 1916. The instrumentation oscillates between Dolores quietly crooning over chorus-drenched guitars with a haunting delay-infused lead poking around the edges of her storytelling before fuzz-wrapped power chords come crashing in for the chorus as Dolores' singing turns to a wail, a desperate cry of a broken people looking for an end to their seemingly endless nightmare, one voice encapsulating decades and indeed centuries of sectarian strife. The track's striking music video plays with Christian iconography, seeing O'Riordan singing underneath a crucifix interspersed with footage of army units prowling the streets and children playing and living amongst the rubble and ruin created by car bombs and other terroristic acts perpetrated in the name of a free and united Ireland. I will note that while both bands are of Irish origin, neither calls Northern Ireland home, both residing in the south of the country in the areas surrounding Dublin. Their distance from the conflict could be construed as insulating them from the horrors of it, which in a way is true, but they suffer, in my view, from the same kind of mass psychological trauma that any citizen of a country at war experiences, much like the American public after 9/11, regardless of whether you resided in or near New York on the day the towers fell. 4 years after the Cranberries released Zombie, 16 years after U2's Bloody Sunday, and more than 80 years since the modern struggle for Irish independence began, the Good Friday Agreement was signed in an effort to end the violence and culture of terror in Northern Ireland. The IRA agreed to wholesale disarmament while the government committed to comprehensive police and political reform. It created a tenuous peace. The tanks and bombs that Dolores O'Riordan saw in her dreams were finally made a thing of the past, with the Cranberries even being invited to perform the song at the 1998 Nobel Peace Prize ceremony that saw the architects of the Good Friday Agreement honored with the award. Despite these positive steps, no agreement can fully remove old religious and sectarian divides from Northern Irish society. The so-called peace walls that separate Protestant communities from Catholic ones still stand, and the trenches dug within the hearts of the Northern Irish people that Bono references are still very much alive.
What does it mean to you to be unionist?
It's just really the tradition that I've grown up around, you know, with my dad and then There was a stage I actually fell out with him over something because I was about to go with a Catholic, but I didn't, and then he fell out with me over that.
He fell out with you about going out with a Catholic girl?
I didn't go out with her, though. I was close to her, then I didn't.
Yeah.
But I didn't really understand it. And then I started telling my stories about the things he grew up around. Kind of understood then, like, right, I kind of have to, like, stick by this now, type of thing.
So would you go out with a Catholic girl now?
Not really. I suppose I can't really, because I've got a girlfriend and all, so...
Violence has flared in recent years because of Britain's impending exit from the European Union, as Irish nationalists fear that a hard border will once again exist between the Republic of Ireland and the North, recreating the conditions under which the Troubles festered, which has the potential to breathe new life into the IRA's paramilitary wing that hasn't operated with regularity in more than two decades. The modern situation is soundtracked by artists like Kneecap, a rap collective focused on reviving the traditional Irish language for modern use, whose lyrics lean heavily on themes of Irish nationalism and are unabashed in the face of heavy public resistance from politicians and audiences alike, much in the way that U2 remained steadfast in the face of IRA threats in the decades previous. Human history had never witnessed something quite like the Cold War. Two world superpowers with the ability to annihilate every molecule of existence with the push of a couple of buttons balanced on a knife's edge for the better part of 30 years. For all of those years, the people of the world lived with a dangling anvil over their heads, just out of sight, waiting for the right moment to snuff out the flame of their lives without warning. They watched countries like Vietnam, Korea, Guatemala, and Chile all devolve into proxy wars between the capitalist West and communist East, leaving each country's infrastructure in ruin and populace with a series of wounds of all kinds, physical, psychological, and political, that have yet to be fully healed to this day. Indeed, the entire world system seemed to exist to fuel the ever-escalating battle of ideologies born out of the triumphs of the Second World War. The 1980s saw the conflict flare to life with renewed fire, as U.S. foreign policy during the Reagan administration pursued an increasingly hardline and aggressive stance towards the Soviet Union, leading to some of the most intense nuclear posturing between the two countries since the Cuban Missile Crisis years previously. It would have been a fair expectation for the music of this period to deal with the subject matter with a sense of gravity and anxiety, indulging in the fear and darkness as a method for shared catharsis. By and large, however, many of the artists who chose to face this topic head-on execute on it by approaching it with a surprising amount of levity, dark humor, and acceptance of this being the status quo, rather than struggling with despair in the face of the potential apocalypse. Tears for Fears is one of the most prolific names amongst a slew of glam-infused synth-rock acts of the mid to late 80s, known for their slickly produced grooves on tracks like Shout and Woman in Chains. Their career-defining song came in the form of Everybody Wants to Rule the World from their international smash hit record, Songs from the Big Chair. The moody shuffle of the opening groove builds into a proper sing-along for the chorus as dual frontman Roland Orzabal and Kurt Smith regale the listener with a tale of hubris, greed, and thirst for power. Cautionary tale that will end inevitably with the demise of the protagonist, and indeed, everyone else who currently draws breath, implied to be carried out by another soul in search of the adrenaline rush that power brings. Its non-specific nature makes it inoffensive as a radio hit, but the underlying message it imparts is obviously a shot across the bow of the politicians and leaders whose culture of escalation as a matter of policy in pursuit of geopolitical clout has led the world time and time again to the brink of disaster. The outro feels ever more prescient in the context of our modern world. The short-sighted leaders of yesteryear who pursued the apocalyptic weaponry that hangs over us all without much thought for the consequences beyond winning the nationalistic goals of the arms race are portrayed. Foreign policy experts will placate an increasingly terrified public with the doctrine of mutually assured destruction, assuring us that we'll never need to make use of the stockpile of annihilation. But history shows that no peace lasts forever. After all, everybody wants to rule the world. Much in the same vein, nestled amongst the headstones of other one-hit wonders from this period is the bright, peppy 99 Luft Balloons by German band Nina. A tale of a computer glitch resulting in nuclear holocaust, the track drives itself along with a bouncy synth-based groove in the style of contemporary acts like Olivia Newton-John or Madonna. To a listener whose German hasn't been dusted off since high school, you'd be forgiven for mistaking this one for any number of foreign language synth bops of the time. But underneath the shiny exterior is a tale of true dark humor. The protagonist and their friends pool money together to purchase a series of red balloons that they subsequently release into the air for a cheap thrill. The problem? The nearby military base's computer perceives the balloons, whether through a glitch or poor programming, as being an impending nuclear attack, triggering a chain reaction that results in a truly devastating world conflict. It's the kind of nihilistic tale of woe popular in this era's dystopian science fiction, which often took the form of cyberpunk dystopias as seen in the works like Ridley Scott's masterpiece film Blade Runner, or the short story I Have No Mouth and I Must Scream. The way Nina differentiate themselves from their counterparts here, of course, is that rather than take the dark, twisted view of the world that those examples do, they choose to shroud their story of apocalypse in sugar-sweet melodies and bouncy percussion, papering over the more dire emotions with a sense of almost manic acceptance. With Putin's nuclear saber-rattling bringing the world back to the brink of nuclear confrontation, I can't help but feel some comfort in the works of those who have experienced this kind of anxiety on a much grander scale and chose to met it with dark humor and levity rather than anxiety and fear like so many would have. The world needs a bit more of that kind of thinking amidst the horror-soaked passages of our recent history. The Iraq War and corresponding War on Terror have been omnipresent in the lives of children of my generation. Born in 1999, I was 2 years old when the towers fell on 9/11, and every memory I have is of the world as it was after that earth-changing event. George Bush's unilateral invasion of Iraq, aided and abetted by international partners like Britain's Tony Blair and Spain's Jose Aznar, was a fixture of both popular culture and current events during my formative years of development. My parents were consistent consumers of the nightly news, and in my youth I can remember catching glimpses of certain things. The night sky over Baghdad lit up by American rockets, the burned out remains of vehicles after yet another car bomb, a revolving door of old men standing at the Pentagon podium explaining to the American public why more and more of their neighbors' sons were coming home in body bags. My father, like many working class Americans, was also an avid listener of country radio at the time. The Nashville scene of the 90s that bled into the early 2000s was a radically different place from the genre-bending, party-driven mess that it has devolved into in the last decade. Artists like George Strait and Garth Brooks were music royalty. Shania Twain was scoring a series of crossover hits, and homegrown stars like Faith Hill, Tim McGraw, and others were forging an identity for the genre centered around organic instrumentation and high production values, on display with tracks like McGraw's Just to See You Smile. It also always possessed an undercurrent of conservative values and nationalism masquerading as harmless patriotism. Billy Ray Cyrus's Some Gave All and Brooks and Dunn's Only in America are just a handful of examples, but the genre was littered with these kind of sentiments, affirming national pride and making white American exceptionalism a core tenet of the country music ethos. It's in this world that Toby Keith cut his teeth. Known for his southern rock twang on tracks like How Do You Like Me Now and Should Have Been a Cowboy, Keith's true ascension to mainstream popular consciousness came with his 2002 album Unleashed. Willie Nelson collaboration Beer for My Horses is a rollicking list of gripes with living in the modern world that was a staple of country radio rotation on my ride to school in the morning, its self-righteous cringe flying over my head in the face of its catchy hook and groove. The record's opening number, courtesy of the Red, White, and Blue, parentheses, The Angry American, was even more blunt with its messaging. Written as a jingoistic power fantasy about America's military might and nationalistic pride, it's a direct response to the attacks of 9/11, but also a rebuke to the growing chorus of voices who countered that sending more Americans to die in a war illegal under international law amounted to nothing more than cheap revenge. Keith butters you up with a pair of verses setting the scene of his patriotic upbringing brought on by his recently deceased father's military service before resorting to cheap symbolism on the chorus to try to rally you behind a war whose civilian death toll rose with each passing minute. The song's most memorable and oft-maligned moment comes in the form of its bridge, an immature, insecure slice of macho posturing which reads,
"Justice will be served, battle will rage, good guys win every time you rattle their cage. Man, you'd be sorry you mess with my U.S. of A. We'll put a boot in your ass. It's the American way.
Lindsay Ellis and Todd in the Shadows give this moment a proper roasting in their collaboration Protest Music of the Bush Era. The context I'll add to their analysis is that Keith admitted in an early interview after its release that he wrote it in just 20 minutes. Quote, I wrote, courtesy of the Red, White, and Blue, on the back of a fantasy football sheet that was laying there. I just turned it and wrote around the edges, and in about 20 minutes, I wrote the lyric out and called it The Angry American, Keith once said. When I turned it in, they said, well, it really doesn't say Angry American in there. Why don't you call it courtesy of the Red, White, and Blue? So I did. End quote. Its rushed nature shows in its brutally mediocre lyricism, but it is also the best indication of a subset of the nation's attitude towards the war. Namely, that those who had perpetrated the crimes of 9/11, or at very least, whoever war criminals like Donald Rumsfeld and Dick Cheney claimed were responsible, were deserving of the full weight of America's unmatched military power, civilian casualties, and nation building be damned. And truly, people had made up their minds about who was responsible before the towers had even fallen. Howard Stern, broadcasting live on the radio for the duration of the crisis, was very clear about where he believed they had come from and the appropriate response, which bore a striking resemblance to the jingoistic power fantasies of Keith's song.
Whoa!
Oh my God!
We're under attack.
Going into buildings.
From our vantage point, yeah, clearly difficult to tell.
We're under attack.
What type of plane that is, but it's a horrific scene.
All right, we've just been told also, Michael, sorry, the New York Stock Exchange is being evacuated, as is, I'm sure, much of Wall Street, if not all of it, as much as possible. But the New York Stock Exchange has suspended trading for the moment.
It's war. Come on.
Everyone tries to get out.
It's
the Japanese.
It's Japanese.
This is Pearl Harbor.
It is. We got to go bomb everything over there now.
We got to bomb the hell out of them. You know who it is. I can't say, but I know who it is.
That's crazy.
This is more upsetting than me.
And they got through.
Does anybody
and they got
a plane question through. Now whether this is terrorism?
Well, we know it's terrorism, and I'm telling you, a country has to be... You know, this reminds me of Japan attacked us in World War II, Pearl Harbor. They were the only country ever to attack the United States like this. And we took an A-bomb, and we blew the daylights out of them. Harry Truman knew. They were still screwing around at the end of the war.
It was 4 years later.
4 years later, they dropped an atomic bomb on their ass. And we got to drop atomic bombs.
There's got to be a war. That's like, all there is to.
But a devastating war where people die.
No stopping this.
Burn their eyes out with atomic bombs.
And don't want to hear about casual
and about how you,
civilians. Casualties.
Far
we got civilian casualties.
People work in the trade.
If this guy Bush doesn't go to war right now, I'm telling you,
you got to know where to go.
We know where
to
go.
Well, you know what?
Don't you know?
If they didn't do it, they better surrender right away.
Yeah, they should all surrender right now.
I'd rather Martin Sheen stepped up than Bush right now.
The other side to this coin in music, albeit not as commercially viable, came in the form of tracks like Thursday's War All the Time. The title track to their debut major label effort, War All the Time, is emblematic of Thursday's broader discography. The moody, spoken word journey sees vocalist Jeff Rickley wrestle with the concept of aging against a rapidly shifting societal backdrop. Rickley isn't dealing with the tragedy of 9/11 or the war in Iraq directly like Keith. Rather, he uses it as a framing device for the ways in which his youth and adolescence has been defined by conflict. The background noise of his coming of age, threat of nuclear annihilation, the Three Mile Island power plant disaster, 9/11, and the subsequent war over Iraqi oil fields are all juxtaposed next to the nights he spent cultivating and performing within the legendary New Brunswick, New Jersey basement scene of the late 90s. The things that, as a kid, served as viable lullaby to fall asleep to, are recontextualized as an adult for the horrors they really are, seared into the subconscious of every person who grew up in this era, even those who, like me, couldn't comprehend in the moment the weight of it all. For a direct confrontation of 9/11 specifically, we don't have to look any further than a record Rickley has a production credit on, My Chemical Romance's debut, I Brought You My Bullets, You Brought Me Your Love, which features the track Skylines and Turnstiles, a distortion-soaked car crash whose rough edges really drive home the horror it must have been to be a native of the New York area and witnessing 9/11 in real time. Its bridge reads... Striking to see 9/11 and its aftermath framed in this context, as the majority of the media, especially when it came to music, of the period used the event as a rallying cry, many using it to garner support for the military action undertaken as a response, but there were others who used it as a call to arms against the war as well. Gerard Way dispenses with both approaches, driving at the heart of the American psyche when they ask, quote, "Tell me where we go from here," on the chorus. While so many were ready to gear up for war, the silent majority were sitting with their head in their hands, still trying to process what had just happened in a country that hadn't been attacked in a generation, and whose mainland hadn't seen bloodshed of that scale in over a century. It was the profiteers, spurred on by the awkward silence that Way references in the song's opening lines, who used the tragedy to capitalize on a dazed populace to launch a war predicated on lies and innuendo that would result in somewhere in the neighborhood of 200 times the civilian death toll from 9/11 inflicted upon the just as innocent population of Iraq. The U.S.'s indiscriminate bombing campaign in Iraqi cities like Fallujah that contributed to the unimaginable number of civilian casualties bears a striking resemblance to the brutal destruction Putin is bringing to bear on cities like Kharkiv in the east of Ukraine. And indeed, the results are much the same. Innocents caught in the crossfire of geopolitical forces beyond their control, having their homes and lives destroyed and taken from them without a second thought. The Russians have been met with international condemnation, and rightfully so. The United States carried out their atrocities alongside international allies providing their own firepower to the operation. A shocking number of the war criminals responsible for the coalition forces' invasion of Iraq have been struck down, perhaps by some kind of just God. Colin Powell, the man who sold the invasion to the United Nations based on lies and fairy tales, recently died from COVID-19 complications related to cancer. Donald Rumsfeld, the architect of the War on Terror and one of the most evil men of the modern age, succumbed months earlier to a cancer of his plasma cells. Fitting that these two killers would be removed from this world through the actions of their own cells betraying them, a macabre sense of karmic justice finally coming to bear. Someday soon, we can all hope, the machines that keep Dick Cheney alive will malfunction as well. The former Halliburton CEO, who serves as the living embodiment of the military-industrial complex, will eventually be claimed by the same reaper who came for his colleagues. The world did not hold these men accountable in life. Cheney and Rumsfeld were allowed to quietly transition out of the public eye, while Powell and George W. Bush have spent the last decade carefully cultivating a new role for themselves in American politics, positioning themselves as level-headed moderates in the modern sea of QAnon-infused lunatics who have a stranglehold on the GOP. They were allowed to escape any consequences for the illegal, evil, and heinous acts that were committed on their watch and in some cases on their orders. Their war of revenge in Iraq achieved nothing more than senseless death and destruction wrought both on the innocent populace of Iraq, but also on the impressionable, naive young adults swept up in the nationalist fervor post-9/11 who would never make it home from that far-flung land. Let's make sure we aren't making the same mistake with the Russian butchers currently rampaging through Ukraine, and those that will come after, regardless of nation of origin, because if we learn anything from history, it's that there will always be a next time. Everybody wants to rule the world.